So today, my job is to give you something to link to all these kings and queens. So when you look at like the name Ivan the Terrible or Henry VIII, it's not just a name on a test, but you can actually visually picture that person and go, oh yeah, he's the guy that did this, or she's the girl that did this. So like I said, as long as you take good notes and really like soak this in and pay attention, it should really help you on your test, okay? So my job was to dig up dirt. That was my job. And we're gonna do that. Now the title of this is Wars of Religion, because obviously there's a lot of wars going on between these kings and queens, but especially at the beginning, we're just gonna talk about the different leaders, okay? So let us begin with a womanizer, King Henry VIII of England. He is known for his wives, and not only his wives, but killing his wives in particular. There were six of his wives, but in order to understand his story, it's kind of important to act it out. I know that sounds crazy. So those of you at home that are sick or whatever, I'm sorry you're gonna miss out on these good-looking people, but I think you'll follow along. Okay, so here's the deal. All right, come on up, sir. You are the king of England.
Oh.
All right, and this king married Catherine of Spain. I need someone with dark hair. Kira, come on up, please. Okay, so come on over here, Queen Catherine. Yes, please. There you go. Okay, go stand. And they got married. However, he was much older than her. They got married to kind of keep peace between England and France, or England and Spain. So King died supposedly before they even conjugated. That means had sex in their marriage. So bye-bye, King, you die. And his younger brother took over. King Will, come on up. Actually, his name was not Will. It was King Henry VIII. Come on over. Now, here's the problem. You still have the queen from the prior marriage, right? But now you have a new brother in charge. So what do you do with the old queen? He felt bad. So he's like, well, I will marry my brother's wife. So you're married. Link up there. Give her an arm. So you know you're married. They actually were married. She was older than him, but they were married for 20-some years. And they're trying to have kids. And it's all about having a boy, because you want a male heir to take over the throne, right? They did have a daughter. Her name was Mary, who will eventually be known as Bloody Mary. Go ahead and wear that, Bloody Mary. But we'll talk about her later on a little bit more. You can just kind of like hang out over here with Catherine. Okay. And they kept trying and trying, but they wanted to have a boy, because it doesn't matter if you have a girl, you need a boy for the male heir to the throne. They actually had five babies die, either from miscarriage or died shortly after they were born. It's really kind of a sad story. So, and by the way, I want you to know, if you look at this picture of Henry, he was actually a very good-looking guy in his youth. The paintings you see most of the time are when he's older and fat, but he was actually really good-looking when he was younger. He was very athletic and very competitive. In fact, there's the story is crazy. He went to go and negotiate with the king of France, and they were both about in their 20s. They were young, athletic, good-looking guys, right? Well, the French king was being a snooty brat, like making fun of him and stuff. So he challenged him to a wrestling match in front of the entire royal court. And they did. So can you imagine these two guys grappling, going at it in front of all of this royalty? And the king lost. The king of England lost. So he was shamed. He was so mad. He's like, we're going to war against France because of a wrestling match. Luckily, his advisors are like, cool down, young pup. It's going to be okay. We're not going to war over your pride. So they didn't, but just shows you he was very competitive, very athletic, very good looking. All right. The other thing about this guy is he was quite the ladies' man. He had six wives, but that doesn't count the hundreds that he probably slept with. He was quite the guy. So even while he's married to Catherine, he is sleeping around with all kinds of girls. All right. So yes, he is a dog, man. So while the queen is doing queenly duties, taking care of his daughter, he's doing his stuff and cheating with different girls. Well, they realize he's not happy with Catherine because he can't have a male heir. So everybody in the country is trying to throw their daughters near him to try to, like, entice him to take their daughter, including the Boleyn family. So let's see here. I need you. Come on up. And I need you. Come on up. Okay. So this is Mary Boleyn. And this is Anne Boleyn. And they also have a brother named George, and he'll be a part of the story later, so we'll talk to you later, George. Okay? All right. So what happens is, while the queen is taking care of the baby back in castle, he goes to visit the Boleyns. And Mr. Boleyn says, check out my daughter, Anne. Yeah, can you imagine, like, basically selling your daughter off like this as a mistress? So they basically went on a date. They went hunting. But she was really good at horseback riding and stuff like that. So she actually showed him up, and he fell off his horse. Well, you don't do that to the king. That's, like, shameful. Shame on you. They sent her to her bedroom. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Oh, my gosh.
You never show up a man in this day. So they took their other daughter and said, why not take Mary instead? Can you imagine? So they throw the other daughter in. Now, it's interesting because they kind of got each other. Because this was the favorite of the sisters. You weren't. Henry was the second brother, right? So they kind of understood what it was like to be the unfavored child. And they sleep together right away. Yeah. And she gets pregnant. Hold your tummy out there, Mary Boleyn. Yep. Okay. So they're having a whole little fling. Well, the problem is she almost miscarries. And in that day, if you had a miscarriage or close miscarriage, they blame that on the fact that you were sinning and God was, like punishing you. So here's what they would do. They would take the pregnant woman over here, and they put her in a locked up room that was dark with no sunlight, and they would put a cross in there, and she would have to pray every minute of every day for God to forgive her for her sins, and maybe she would get to keep her baby. So now notice, King Henry has no woman to please him, and he's a ladies' man, right? So he starts looking around again because he can't be with her. Well, Anne comes back into the picture. She's mad at her sister for stealing the king from her, and so she decides to go and beguile the king and flirt, you little flirt. So come on over there, Anne. You're flirting with King Henry. Oh, my gosh. But see, Anne was smart. Mary gave it up right away, right? And when you give it up, the guy takes off pretty quick. But Anne knew that if she didn't give sex up, he would stick around longer. She was smart. So he would say, please, please, please. And she would say, not until I have a ring on my finger. And he says, what are you talking about? I'm still married to Catherine. I can't marry you. I'm married to her. And in the Catholic faith, it is a sin to get a divorce. So I cannot be divorced. So she's basically got him mesmerized, honestly. Completely mesmerized, but she's still controlling him. Meanwhile, Mary over here finally has a baby. And guess what? It's a boy. It's the boy that he wants, but now he has promised himself to Anne. So he sends Mary home. So go to your seat, Mary. You're going home. Yep. Okay, so now the problem is she's still like, I don't want to be with you because we're not married yet. So he does something nobody could ever believe. He broke from the Catholic Church of Rome. They're still Catholic, but now they called themselves the Church of England so that he could get rid of his wife. What he did is he sent her to a nunnery, a convent. So you and your little Mary went to a convent, so you get to go to your convent. Thank you. You're home. There you go. And Anne and Henry get married. Link up arms. You're now married. Got it? Yeah, there you go. Grab his arm. There you go. Yeah, there you go. Okay. But by the time they get married, they both start to not like each other very much because they're starting to realize that Anne is a little witch. I mean, let's be honest. She is a conniving little witch. She is, right? I mean, she's done this to her sister and blah, blah, blah. And meanwhile, King Henry is starting to go mad. He actually starts to go mentally crazy in the later part of his life, and he gets mean. So they're together, but it's like forced, and they fight all the time. They do have one child. Hurrah, hurrah. And her name is Elizabeth. Elizabeth, go ahead and wear this for now. You don't have to come up, but we'll use you later on. But that is still not a boy. We need a boy, right? Anne gets pregnant again.
Oh, I'm pregnant.
You're pregnant. Okay. And now he's like, I'm not touching her because she's pregnant. Besides, they fight all the time. So he's over here cheating on her and doing all crazy stuff. One night, Anne has a miscarriage, loses the baby. And her brother and sister, George and Mary, come to comfort her. Where are you? George, come on up. Mary, come on up. You come to comfort her because you feel bad for her. And she tells her brother, get rid of it. Get rid of the evidence. So he takes it and buries the baby somewhere, unknown grave. Okay? But that night, they're discussing it. And those of you that saw the movie, The Other Boleyn Girl, you get to tell us, what does she tell her brother? Yes. Says, George, my brother, you must have sex with me so I can get pregnant. Mary is shocked and horrified. She's like, I can't believe you would do this. She runs home again. So was running home. So here's what happens. Okay, now understand. Imagine sleeping with your brother or sister. Pretty sick, right? But this is what I told the people at movie night. Remember, though, if he doesn't do this for his sister, she's going to die. Because Anne knows that by now the king is moving on to another girl. If she doesn't have a boy, he is going to kill her and move on to the next girl. She can tell it's coming. So would you sleep with your brother or sister to save their life? Don't answer out loud. Don't answer, I don't want to know. But that's the situation that that brother was in. The dirty deed. And there's more to the story. Isn't this a soap opera? Okay, George is also married. And his wife peeks in. You can just peek. And sees those two in bed. So she goes and tells the king. Go tell the king what you saw. Yeah, brother and sister are sleeping together. Oh my gosh. Okay, so, and then she goes back. Now the king believes that they have slept together. The problem is they go to do the deed and they're like, I can't do it. You know, you're my brother. It's too gross. So they don't. And Anne just says, I'm going to go and throw myself at the mercy of the king and I pray that he forgives me. That's all I can do. And of course, she's talking about losing the baby, right? So George goes back to his cottage, and Anne goes to see the king the next day, and he's going to beg for mercy for losing the baby in the miscarriage. Little does she know that the king has been told they slept together. She doesn't even know that. So she's like, it's not my fault. I didn't mean to. It just happened naturally. And he's thinking about them sleeping together. He accuses her of witchcraft and treason. And the reason he said you're a witch is because only a witch would sleep with her sibling, right? That's why she was charged with witchcraft. He eventually cuts her head off and cuts his head off too, and they both die. So the only person left from this thing is their baby, a daughter, Elizabeth. Right? Give everybody a hand. They're doing great so far. Thank you. You guys can have a seat for now. Just have a seat for now, okay? Yeah. That's going to come up later. Just hold on to him for right now. So here's the deal. That is only two of his wives. There are six of them.
Wow.
You know, because he never married Mary. He just slept with her. So understand that there are a lot, it is a real life soap opera if you really study Henry VIII. It is a crazy, crazy story. So now that you've seen that, at least you'll kind of understand your notes now. Are you ready? So remember his first wife was Catherine of Spain with the beautiful dark hair, right? Okay. Which was his brother's wife. They were married for a long time. He was 19, she was 26. They were married for 24 years until she couldn't give him a son. And she eventually went through menopause, and he knew that he couldn't get another boy from her. So then he starts looking, and he starts sleeping around with the Boleyn sisters, right? And he eventually breaks from the Catholic Church in order to marry Anne Boleyn. And they create the Church of England. Now, in that day, of course, that was like a horrendous thing to do. But understand that those of you that are Protestant today, you might be grateful for that. Because even though this was still a Catholic church, it opened the door for Protestantism and other options. So otherwise, we might all be Catholic today. Could be. I don't know. All right. Now, there's a rhyme that they used to teach children so they would remember what happened to the six wives of Henry VIII. And it goes like this. It goes, divorce, beheaded, died. Divorce, beheaded, survived. Divorce, beheaded, died. Divorce, beheaded, survived. And now you get it, right? So the first wife was divorced. That was Catherine. Second wife was beheaded. That was Anne Boleyn. The third one died of regular death stuff. The fourth one, he divorced. The fifth one, he beheaded again. And the sixth one outlived him. So he had six wives. They were Catherine of Aragon, Anne Boleyn, Jane Seymour, Anne of Cleves, Catherine Howard, and Catherine Parr. And we will actually hear more about the daughters of those marriages coming up later on in a few slides. So he was kind of an interesting collector. He had 50 different palaces. He also liked to collect handguns. He had 6,500 of them. And he was a composer. He loved music. So he had a collection. He had 78 different flutes. 78 recorders. Remember the recorder you played in like elementary school, you know? He even had a harpsichord. The other thing I want you to remember about him is that he is known for being crazy, especially in the later part of his life. We believe he was suffering from syphilis. What is syphilis? Yes, an STD. Not to scare you, but if you don't treat certain STDs, it can actually cause brain damage. And that's what happened with syphilis back then, because they didn't have treatment like we do today. So we believe that's actually what was causing it. Song that goes, I am Henry VIII, I am Henry VIII, I am. About him being crazy. I think the Beatles sang it, actually. All right, so we're going to go from the ladies' man to the scary man. Let's go to Ivan the Terrible of Russia. And boy, if you look at that picture, boy, I wouldn't want to run into him in an aisle, right? An alley, scary guy. He ruled from 1547 to 1584. Now, the first half of his reign, he was not quite so violent. But the second half, he really made up for it and earned that name, Ivan the Terrible. We think the reason he was more violent in the second half is because of the same reason we had trouble with Henry VIII, because we think he had syphilis. He was a ladies' man, and that he was having problems mentally because of that. Yeah. Now, back in that day, the treatment for syphilis was mercury. What do you know about mercury? It's poisonous. Where do we see mercury? Yeah, remember your glass thermometers? I don't know if your parents ever did this, but my parents are like, don't bite it, you'll die. You know the mercury in there? Yeah, because in certain doses, it is lethal. Well, that's what they gave them for a treatment. Now, remember that. We're going to come back to that in a minute. He learned his violence from his family, unfortunately. He was raised in the castle like a royal, but unfortunately, he was not treated like a royal. His uncle was the king. And his uncle was afraid that he would rise up and overthrow him, so he treated him like a beggar. This poor kid had scraps for clothes, no shoes. He would have to go and beg for scraps of food at the back of the kitchen in order to eat because they didn't feed him, and his uncle would molest and beat him almost every day. And that's his role model. So he thinks that's what you should be as a man, right? And he definitely starts to show those symptoms. As a child, we know he killed animals like cats and dogs just for fun. As a teenager, he would take girls out on dates and then rape and kill them for fun. And nothing was done because he was a royal family. He was married 7 times, sometimes divorcing in 1 week because she wore the wrong thing to dinner. So he definitely, I don't think he understood the idea of love. Because I don't think he was ever loved as a kid. You know what I mean? His population was horrible. It falls drastically while he's in power. He started a war with 4 different countries for over 24 years. And then if that wasn't bad enough, battle deaths, the plague hits and just plummets their population. He also killed off his own people. One of those examples was a city called Novgorod. He believed that these people were not loyal to him, so he killed all 60,000 people, wiped the entire town off the map. He also ended up being violent to his family. So I want you to imagine, okay, you two, you know, you're the king's son, and you're newly married, and she is going to have a baby. You're all excited, right? Going to have a new baby. Well, at dinner, his daughter-in-law wore something that was a little too showy of skin, you know, probably a little too much cleavage or something. So he called her in. And Ivan the Terrible always carried this staff with a ball on top of it, and he beat her with it for what she wore to dinner. And it caused her to have a miscarriage. Now, can you imagine that? AJ, can you imagine like your own dad beating your wife? And so bad that they lose their baby? Can you imagine? Wouldn't that be horrible? What do you think you'd do? I was going to say, maybe you'd get in a fight with him? Well, that's what happened. His son went in and said, "How dare you? How could you do that to my wife and my baby? Blah, blah, blah." Well, his dad took his staff, hit him across the head with it. Didn't mean to, but he killed his son. And according to everything I have read, that is the only time he regretted anything he did. And I don't know that it was a love thing. It was the fact that that was his male heir to the throne, and he just killed him. So he did feel regret for that. There is some mystery about how he died. So in the 1960s, they dug up his remains to do some testing, because obviously we have more ability now, CSI and all. And they found his body was full of mercury. There are actually 2 theories to his death. And this is what happened when he died. He was sitting at a table playing chess with his advisor, and he dropped dead in the middle of the game. So many people actually accused the advisor of poisoning him. And he had good reason, because earlier he had just tried to rape the advisor's sister. So obviously if that happened, I'm sure you'd be really angry. Maybe you want to poison him. But on the other hand, remember we said the treatment for syphilis is mercury, right? So it could be that just all of the treatments eventually caught up and killed him because of his syphilis too. We don't know. There's no way to really prove it. We just know he died of mercury, whether it was actually intentional poisoning or accidental, we're not sure. So now remember I told you, he killed his son who was supposed to be the next king, right? Well, the only other king he had, unfortunately in this case, was a mentally handicapped son who had the ability of like a first grader. Do any of you have a brother or sister who's a first grader in here? Second grader? No, all your siblings are older. Can you imagine a first grader running a country, like as a president? Be scary, right?
President.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's what happened. His mentally handicapped son was the next king. And that is why they call this time period the time of troubles. Because this guy just didn't have the ability, you know? He couldn't run the country. And so there were uprisings, people were starving. It was just a mess. They thought Ivan was bad. It was even worse when his son took over. Now, the next king that we're really known, Russia is known for, is a guy named Peter the Great. The reason he is called Peter the Great is because think of where they've been. They've been with Ivan, who is the worst guy possible, and they've been with his son, who had no ability. So when Peter came in and he was a decent leader, they called him Peter the Great, and that's why he got that name. So explains why they call him that. So let's talk about old Peter the Great here. Peter ruled from 1682 to 1725. All right, so if you look at Peter the Great here in this picture, you'll see he kind of looks like he's all put together, but he has his own quirks just like any of us do. The first thing you might want to know about Peter the Great, he was actually 7 feet tall. My gosh. I mean, think about that. We think that's tall even today, right? Imagine what that would be like back then. Because as a human being, we have gotten bigger and taller over the years. The average man was under 5 foot in that day. So I'm sure to most people, he would seem like a giant. Who's my tallest person in here? So you're 6'1", right? Okay, come on up here. And let me show you how tall this guy would be. Now, I think that he is tall compared to me, right? You look down at me. But if you'll take a look, let me put this up here next to you. Look at the top of this yardstick. That is how tall Peter the Great would have been. Incredible. That's even tall for you. Now, I wish we could say that Peter the Great was as muscular as you are right here. But it said that he was actually a beanpole, that he was very scrawny and all gangly with all arms and legs, and he tripped over his arms and legs a lot. So he was a little bit clumsy. It also said in his documentation that, how did they put it? That he jerked uncontrollably at times or something like that. Remember that they had symptoms back then, but they didn't have the diagnosis that we do today. So we believe that either he had a nervous tic, or maybe, you know what, maybe he was epileptic. Maybe he was having seizures or something like that too. So he definitely had his own issues just like we all do. He is most known for modernizing and Europeanizing Russia. He went and visited the kings of Europe, in particular France, the Louis, and he just could not believe how behind Russia was compared to Europe. And so he said, we've got to catch up. We've got to modernize our country. So the first thing he did is he built the strong navy in Russia. They didn't have one before. So he was the first person to do that. Then he also changed some of their habits in their country. First of all, in Russia at that time, every man pretty much had a long, scraggly, pointed beard, kind of like Tuck Dynasty, for example, right? You guys know them. Well, then he went to Europe, and he saw that men shaved their beards, or the beards they had were very trim and very nicely cut. So believe it or not, he outlawed having a beard. Now, you could keep your beard, but if you wanted to keep it, you actually had to pay a tax in order to keep the beard that you wanted. The other thing that he found in Europe was that they were marrying for love, for amour, right? Well, in Russia, if a young lady was ready to be wed, she was about that age, the parents and the daughter would meet with the local matchmaker, and she would pair her with a gentleman that would be suitable to both families. And usually they would look at how much money he had, the kind of status he had, and as a parent, you wanted those things for your daughter. You wanted someone that was had some popularity, powerful ability, or some money to support her. Well, he came back and said, hey, no more arranged marriages. And he thought that would be awesome because you could now marry for love. Well, as teenagers, they were like, yes, I can marry whoever I want. But actually, a riot broke out, literally a physical riot broke out. Because here was the problem. What if, Emily, you choose to marry a slug that never gets off the couch, doesn't get a job, and has no money? How would your parents feel about that? Right, not very happy, right? So the reason they were so angry is the parents didn't have any control over what type of guy you could fall in love with. So they really didn't like that a whole lot. The other thing that he changed was dancing, believe it or not. Before he went to Europe, they would dance separately, girls and guys. So the guys would go out in a circle and they would do this thing that goes like, hoi, 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 kick their legs out if you've ever seen that. And then the girls out would do their little dance. Well, then he saw in Europe that they were doing the waltz with a girl and a guy dancing together. So it really changed Russia much for the better, I think, in a lot of ways. While he was in Europe, he did have some problems. So these are some examples of his violence. A rebellion broke out. It did fail, but he knew he had to make an example of them. Because after the time of troubles, there have been numerous uprisings and all kinds of trouble. So he took those guys and he tortured them and he killed them and he put their bodies on display in the town square. So this is what happens if you try to mess with the Tsar or the King of Russia. I'm sad to say he was also violent to his own family. His son's name was Alexei. He was an only son. And he was a military general, some officer anyway. And his dad had ordered him to do some certain thing on battle, and he disobeyed his father's orders. So believe it or not, he had his own son tortured and killed on his orders. Now that seems crazy to us, right? Can you imagine killing your own son? But there are examples of this throughout history. It's crazy. For example, I'll never forget this story as long as I live. I was in college, and we were studying the Caesars of Rome, Roman history. And they were telling us about this one Caesar. His wife had just gotten pregnant, and she's all happy and stuff. And so he and his wife go into the bedroom. And this is going to sound weird. Hang with me. He says, wife, let me tie you to the bedpost. So they had like a canopy bed. And I'm sure she's thinking, what in the world? But she did. So he tied her hands up high up above her. And she thought everything was okay until she saw him get out the dagger. And then he took that dagger and he stuck her and gutted her from navel to nose, killing his wife and his baby. The reason? He was so paranoid that this baby, who had not even been born yet, would rise up and overthrow him, he decided to kill both of them. Well, I think that's the case here with Peter the Great. His son Alexei has been disobeying orders. He's in his early 20s. He is old enough now to overthrow his dad. He's a military general, so his soldiers follow him. And I think that's probably why. I think he was worried about him maybe taking over his throne. He also had some health problems. He couldn't pee. How irritating. So they cut him open, and in surgery they found he had 4 pounds of blocked urine inside him. Can you imagine how uncomfortable that would be? So they emptied all that out, and they sewed him back up. The story of his death goes like this. There was a soldier that was drowning in a freezing river over here, and he jumped in, and he saved the soldier, and he died of saving the soldier. Well, the truth is, we really think he died of his bladder problems, because when he jumped in that freezing water, it exacerbated his wound and his bladder issues, and he ends up dying of gangrene, actually. Now, this is my favorite story of all time about Peter the Great. You're going to think I'm lying, but it's the truth. It's just like a soap opera. He's killed his only remaining heir to the throne, right? So nobody knows who's going to be the next king, and he's on his deathbed. It could be his uncle, his cousin, anybody, right? All related. So all of these people are standing around his deathbed waiting for him to say, so-and-so is going to be the next king. And he's laying there and he says, I leave all to... And he died. He died before he could tell anybody who was supposed to be the next king, just like in a soap opera, I told you. So after that, there was a scramble among the family about who would be the next to reign and rule in Russia. Okay, if you need to, before we go into France, we're moving from Russia into France, why don't you get up and stretch just a little bit? Okay, so let's talk about Henry IV, or Henry of Navarre of France. Now, I'm going to warn you, there are 2 Henry IVs, one of England and one of France. This is the French Henry IV. And remember, you can use any of this information for your rap battles, so be keeping those in the back of your mind. Henry IV ruled from 1399 to 1413, only 14 years. And the reason for that is he was not a royal. He was a military general. He was the leader of the Huguenots. Huguenots is one of your test questions. Huguenots are French Protestants. France had been Catholic for years and years, and the Protestants had absolutely no rights, so they decided to rise up and bow, and they did. Thousands and thousands of people lost their lives, but in the end, the Huguenots were victorious. So they took their military general, Henry of Navarre, and they made him the new king of France. Now, this is kind of a really funny story. So, yes, he became king, but it actually took a 9-year siege of Paris to get the actual crown for his head from the Spanish, who were hiding it from him in Paris because they didn't want anybody to get the crown except for a Catholic king. So they were very upset about that. Now, let's tell you the rest of the story with Henry of Navarre. Okay, so remember, he's the leader of the Protestants. They fought a whole war to get him there. And you would think as soon as he became king, the first thing he would do would be what? Yeah, either kill all the Catholics or say, hey, Protestants, you can worship any way you want. Well, unfortunately, it didn't quite go that way. The first thing he did when he became king is he became a Catholic. He joined the enemy side at this time. What in the world is he thinking? The people were furious in the Huguenot crowd. I mean, that would be like Abraham Lincoln fighting the Civil War so that we can get rid of slavery, and then after they win the war, say, by the way, let's have slaves again. I mean, people bled and died for this cause, right? But here's what he said, and this is a really famous quote in world history. He said, Paris is well worth a mass. Meaning, he knew that France had been Catholic for so many years, there is no way they would have accepted a Protestant king. They just weren't ready yet. There's no way. So he said, I will convert to Catholicism for the good of the country. I'll go and say my Hail Marys and I'll go to Mass just so that we can keep the peace with the people. But then you ask, what did he do for his Huguenot brothers? He did help them out in the Edict of Nantes. The edict has basically two statements. The first statement doesn't help them much. He basically just said, Catholicism is the official religion of France. Okay? But the second thing he said was that all French people had freedom of worship. So even though he didn't, like, make the country Protestant, he said that Protestants could worship for the first time. And that was a pretty big deal, too. So some people consider that a victory. Some people consider that a compromise. But that's what he did. Now, a couple of fun stories about Henry IV. First of all, his wedding day led to the St. Bartholomew's Day massacre because the Catholics thought this would be a perfect day to rise up and overthrow the king because he'd be busy with the wedding, which was true. It led to tons of Protestants getting killed that day, and they actually took the king prisoner for a while. The biggest news about Henry IV is that he made the headlines in 2012. They found his head. His skull was found in an attic in 2012 of a tax collector. I don't remember the whole story, but he found him in this trunk, and it turned out it was Henry IV. Crazy. But yeah, it's quite a cool story. He had a couple of nicknames. He was known as the Green Gallant or the Gay Old Spark because he had many different mistresses. You'll find out French kings were known for their women, for having lots of mistresses. He survived 12 assassination attempts, pretty much all of them Catholic. And he's also known for building the palace where the Louvre is today. What's the Louvre? Good. It's like the most famous art museum in the world, and it's in Paris, France, right? Well, a lot of people don't realize that the Louvre used to be the king's palace, and the Louvre Museum is just like, I don't know, a fourth, maybe a little more, of the castle itself. There's actually a lot of other things in there, too. And the picture that you see down here is actually that palace. If you recognize that glass triangle in front, that's actually a new entrance to the Louvre that was built a few years ago. So he built the palace in Paris. He eventually was assassinated by a Catholic, and he died by being stabbed to death. Not real fun. And he passed his reign on to his son, who will become Louis XIII. So let's learn about Louis XIII. Louis XIII or Louis the Just? Both from 1610 to 1643. Take a look at his picture. He's got a very different look than his dad, doesn't he? That's because this is the guy that made wigs popular. So he is probably wearing a wig in that picture, I would guess. He was called the Just, by the way, because people felt that overall he was a pretty fair guy. Sounds really logical, but it's true. Well, remember that his father was assassinated, so he was given the kingship that way. Well, he was only 3 years old when that happens. And you can imagine a three-year-old can't make any decisions for the country. So it was left up to two people to make those decisions for him until he was old enough to take over. And that was his mother, who, of course, was still the queen, and then Cardinal Richelieu. The cardinal was the leader of the Catholic Church in France, because remember, they are still officially Catholic. And at this time, the Louis were really more Catholic than their dad. So those two ruled until Louis gets a little older. And then once he gets older, you're going to find that they're going to have conflict big time. In fact, the Catholic Church, the cardinal, will actually try to assassinate the king more than once because they don't want to give up power. Makes sense, but it's true. Well, as he got older, he started having problems with his mother because, remember, his mother was a widow. Well, she started sleeping around with an Italian guy. And he claimed that this guy was affecting his mom's judgment and she was making some bad choices for the country. And she wouldn't listen. So he got the last laugh. He actually killed this Italian friend. And then he exiled his own mother from the country. And remember, she is the former queen of France. Now, a mother's revenge is pretty tough, right? She didn't let it sit. Believe it or not, his own mother led more than one revolt against him to try to take over France again. Power and greed, nasty stuff. Louis XIII also faced the Huguenot Rebellion while he was in power. And here's a couple of stories about Louis XIII to put in your mind. Take a look at this picture and you'll never forget this story. We do believe that he was bisexual from the different documentation we've read. And one of the stories was that he had an affair with one of his military generals. And they were meeting in this tent and they were discussing battle strategy and blah, 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 right? Well, he told this guy to go and put on a women's white wedding dress. And then he was seen saying, to bed, my love. And they disappeared. So I can imagine this big burly general with a beard and he's got a white wedding dress on. So that's what I think of. It makes me laugh. Like I said, he's the guy that started wigs as a fashion in Europe. He also was worried about having an heir to the throne. And again, in France, you need to have a boy. They had four stillborns. And then finally, they did have two sons. They had the oldest son who became Louis XIV, and they also had a younger son, which leads us to this theory of what's called the heir and the spare. This has kind of been the way it was back then, and it still is today. So here's how it works. If you have an older brother and a younger brother, the oldest son always gets to be king in the royal family, unless he is incapable of doing so. But here's the sad part about the younger brother. I mean, you know, you're a younger brother. Can you control the fact that you were born second? No, of course not. But even though you cannot be king, you still have to go through all the training, shake all the hands, do all the stuff that your older brother does. Because if he is incapable of serving, if he dies, for example, then you have to take the throne. And that actually was the case in Henry VIII's story. He was the second brother, and his brother died, so he did take over. Most of these brothers never, ever get the glory, even though they have to go through all the work. And that is going on right now in England with these two boys. Do you recognize these two, William and Harry? Prince William here got married just a few years ago. It was a huge wedding, William and Kate. And if you look at all the tabloids, they've just had babies. I swear Kate's on every tabloid known to man. And then he has a younger brother, and his name's Harry. So let's see how this all fits together. Who is really running England right now? Who's in charge? Yes, Queen Elizabeth. Okay. Now, how is Elizabeth related to William? That's his grandma. You're right. Okay, so here's what happened. Okay, yes, there was a king. Elizabeth was married, but her husband died. She is just still living, so she's ruling because she's the queen. Well, Elizabeth and her husband, let me erase this. They had a son named Prince Charles. And who did Prince Charles marry? Do you remember? Diana. Good. Sorry about that. Yeah, he married Princess Diana. And this was a huge wedding for my era. This wedding, well, you know, Will and Kate, that was the big wedding of your day. In my day, my gosh, every TV station had stuff on Charles and Diana. Books were done about it. And part of the reason it was such a big deal is because it was kind of the dreamy princess story that here you have a prince and he married a commoner. Diana was a commoner, just like you and me. She was probably poorer than most of us in this room. And she knows what it means to work hard and have to work for what you get and stuff like that. And here he kind of swept her off her feet. Everybody thought it was so cool. Well, in the end, it wasn't so awesome because Charles ended up sleeping around on his wife. And so they end up getting divorced. Okay. And then a few years after, well, actually, before I say that, they had two kids. They had William, and then they had Harry over here, right? Those are their children. Diana died a few years ago in a car wreck. The paparazzi were chasing her through a tunnel, and she had a car wreck and died. Really sad, but true. But now, here's what's happened. Because Elizabeth has lived so long, our kingship is going to skip a generation. Charles will probably never be king for two reasons. Number one, because of the shame that he's brought to the family because of the affair and the divorce. I think that's part of it. But also, now Will is old enough to take over. So as soon as Grandmom decides she doesn't want to reign or she dies, Will will be the next king. And if he dies, then Harry would take over. But there's also a cool part to Will. Will married Kate over here, right? Kate is also a commoner, just like us. So a lot of people have a lot of faith in what's coming. They think that Will and Kate might be the best king and queen that England has had in a long, long time. Because, first of all, the boys were raised mostly with their mother, and they're more down to earth. They understand people. They're not snooty royals. And then he married a normal person, too. So they're very excited about what's to come. And make sure you kind of watch that in the news as you check out Will's history here. Okay. All right. So I told you the next guy in line was Louis XIV. Louis XIV called himself the Sun King. Question is why? Well, think about it. The planets all revolve around the sun, right? So just like that, all people and all things should revolve around him. He is the center of the universe. And I know that sounds conceited, but they were. These kings were pretty conceited. He believed he was the center of the universe, and he believed in the divine right that God had chosen him. So he had a reason to believe that he was like the chosen one. He also was obsessed with the Greco-Roman god Apollo. And if you know anything about those, you know that he is the god of the sun. So you'll see paintings and statues that Louis did where he portrays himself as a Greco-Roman god Apollo. It's kind of interesting. And he'll actually put golden suns on every building that he works in or enters pretty much. He ruled from 1643 to 1715. Pretty darn long time. He is known as one of the most powerful kings of France. Now, if you look at this picture, gentlemen, I'm talking to you when I ask this question. What is the thing that you notice most? What stands out to you? Yeah, he's got tights on and heels. Maybe looks a little bit feminine with his pose. Yeah, good. It's his legs that stand out. Well, there's a reason for that. When people posed with their legs exposed, it was a sign that he was a good dancer, believe it or not. And he was. He was an excellent dancer. The other thing that we know about this painting is those were probably not his legs. He probably had someone stand in as a leg model for him. And remember, this isn't an Instagram. It doesn't just happen instantly. This is a portrait. So they have to sit there for hours and hours and hours as the painter does their thing. We know that Louis XIV had gout. So he had a bunch of pussy big sores that oozed all over his legs. So his legs would not have been in that good shape. So probably it was someone else that posed for him. Now, not only did he have the old pussy legs, but he had some other issues. According to the descriptions of Louis XIV, it said he stank of the mouth. And I quote that. Well, think about it. Nobody had toothpaste or mouthwash back then. They all stank of the mouth. But if it was important enough for them to write that, it meant that it was worse than most. So he probably had some kind of halitosis or something like that. So he stank of the mouth. The other thing we know about this time period is that most people didn't have all their teeth because they didn't have toothpaste and stuff. So if you had most of your teeth, they would mention it. They would say, wow, he's got good teeth. In his case, they didn't mention it. So probably Louis was missing most of his teeth. So imagine this guy who's all stinky and gouty and, yeah, missing most of his teeth. We also know that he bathed 3 times a year, so he probably had some body odor going on, which, by the way, was probably more than you would have bathed back in that day. In fact, weddings were typically held in the spring for a reason, because it was the first time you could bathe all winter long when the river thawed. So you would go and you would bathe. And the idea was that you wanted to get married while you still smelled kind of good. In fact, that's why brides carried flowers. It was to help disguise the body odor that all people had back then. You just didn't bathe a whole lot. I already told you about his legs. He also had some jealousy issues. He was worried about his nephew overthrowing him. So he had his nephew raised as a girl, which ends up backfiring on him later. He needed someone to be in charge of one of his territories. So as this guy got older, remember, he's now a girl. He said, I need you to go and be king of this territory. Well, he said, I can't. I'm a girl, basically, in everything but physical. And he couldn't use him because he just couldn't adjust to that. It is because of Louis XIV that other countries started having mistresses like the French. Louis XIV was known for having lots and lots of little friends. In fact, we're going to show you a hallway, and he had a bedroom for all of his little ladies that he slept with. And his little servants would go and get whichever lady he wanted in whichever night. And he basically, you know, those kings could have anybody they wanted at any time. You didn't say no to a king. Louis XIV lived to be 77 years old, which is unheard of in that day. You know, most people died before they were 50. So he was the longest reigning European monarch ever. Unbelievable. Now, I mentioned to you that both of these Louis took power when they were, well, I guess I didn't tell you, but the second one was only 4 when he took over. So they were both little boys. How many of you have either seen or read a book about the Three Musketeers? Yeah, over half of you, right? Well, did you know that the Three Musketeers is based on the Louis years? Because those kings were so little, they were little boys, that there were a group of soldiers that came forward called the Musketeers, and their job was to protect the king when he was still too young to be able to protect himself. And that's how the Musketeers came to be. So I'm going to show you just a trailer of the newest version of the Three Musketeers. But you'll notice that the enemies they talk about They mentioned the cardinal who tried to kill both of the Louis at some point. There were two different cardinals that tried to do that. And they also mentioned Buckingham, who is from England. And in the movie, you're going to see he has a more modern kind of invention, like a flying ship. But I want you to think about what those flying ships represent. So you see how they were there to basically protect the king? Yeah, you get that. And then my question for you was, what do those flying ships represent? The power of England? Right, their navy. England has the most powerful navy, gosh, and it makes them the most powerful up until probably World War I, when we start getting planes and other things involved. So, good. All right, let's talk about one more Louis. This is Louis XV. Now, notice that Louis XIV is not, it's not father-son. They skipped a generation. Actually, Louis XIV is his great-grandpa. Because remember, Louis XIV lived to be 77. So this guy's dad and grandpa lived to be, like, they died in the meantime. So they skipped a couple generations. He ruled from 1715 to 1774. A couple of things about him. I didn't find a whole lot of detail, but here's a few things. First of all of his immediate family, like his dad, died of smallpox. He was the only one that survived because his nurse would not allow them to bleed him. So thank goodness for his little nurse. He ended up marrying Queen Maria of Poland. And from everything I've read, he really did love her. However, French kings are French kings, and they do have mistresses. He had 10 kids with her, but only two of them were boys, and only one of them survived. And it's always about having a male heir, like we said. He was also known for his mistresses, just like Louis XIV. However, his was a little bit different. He slept with commoners. And it was in all the newspapers. Holy cow, that he would be with such people. Blah, blah, blah. Oh, it was such a big deal. And if you saw the movie clip that I showed you, remember the old guy that had that girl in the blue dress that was flirting with him? Yeah, that was Louis XV, right? Yep. In fact, in the newspapers, it said that he bathed in the blood of virgins and had 90 illegitimate children running around France. So they definitely thought it was a big deal that he was not just sleeping around, but he was sleeping around with people that were beneath his stature. I found his assassination rather interesting. He was going to get in his carriage, and a guy came up and stuck him like this, bam, right here between the ribs. Amazingly, didn't hit any organs, and he was fine, survived. But now he had to decide what to do. And you'll notice that, yes, Ivan was horrible and violent and stuff like that, but the French kings were lovers, not fighters, for the most part, at this point, okay? But he knew he had to do something with this guy. And it was so unique, I decided I wanted to use the actual words. And I know it's kind of small, so I'll read it out loud so you can fill in your blanks, okay? All right. Damons, the guy that tried to kill him, was carried to the place de Grève in the cold afternoon of that same day. There, he was first tortured with red-hot pincers. So imagine burning him. His hand, holding the knife used in the attempted murder, was burnt using sulfur. Ugh. Then, molten wax, lead, and boiling oil were poured into his wounds. Can you imagine how much that would hurt? Oh my goodness. Horses were then harnessed to his arms and legs for his dismemberment. So, I need one of you to come up here. Would you come up here? Okay, come here. Lay on the floor on your back. And make a big X with your body, all right? Now, you guys, I want you to imagine that he has a horse and a rope tied to this arm going this way, a horse tied to this right arm going this way, and a horse tied to this right foot going this way, and left foot going this way. And then they say, yeah, and all four horses go in all four directions of the globe. The goal is to get him to pull all of his arms and legs off so he bleeds to death. Well, if you look at the account, things didn't go as they had planned. It says, Damon's joints would not break after some hours of attempts. Can you imagine? So representatives of the parliament ordered the executioner and his aides to cut Damien's joints. So they cut him right here on the shoulder line and then right here on the hips so that the tendons would basically break. Damon's was then dismembered to the applause of the crowd. But here's the sad part. He still didn't die. His trunk was still alive. So his trunk, apparently still living, was then tied and burnt at the stake, and he finally died. There was an immense crowd to watch this gruesome spectacle, which nobody had witnessed in France in 147 years. So notice this was not a common thing in France. Balconies and buildings above the Place de Grève were rented to women of the aristocracy for the exorbitant or crazy price of 100 livres per balcony, which is about $700 per ticket, just so these women could go and watch this guy get his arms and legs pulled off. Wow. My last story for you about Louis XV, I can get to come up here, is about his death. He eventually did die of the thing he was saved from when he was a child. He died of smallpox. And you'll notice the notes say his heart was not cut out. So let me explain what that means. Sounds crazy. There was a time in France before this where the king died. They went out on the balcony. They told the people, "I'm sorry, our king has died." They grieved, had the funeral, moved on to the next king. Well, a few years later, lo and behold, here comes the king that had supposedly died, and he shows up with his army, overthrows the new leader, and takes over. They found that they had lied. It's not like they have CNN where you can see the dead body on TV, right? So he had faked it. So from then on, they ordered that when a king died, they would cut his heart out and put it in a jar to show the people that he truly was dead. Okay, so in this case, because of respect for his wife, from what I read, they didn't cut his heart out. So for years, it was kind of like the Elvis sightings belief. Some people believe Elvis is still alive somewhere. They thought that Louis XV was still alive and he was going to come back someday and overthrow France. They thought they saw him here, saw him there. It was a crazy thing, but it was a really big thing across France. All right, I think we're going to stop right there for day one, and we'll continue tomorrow.